If we could just try hard enough, if we could just stop sinning so much, if we could just get serious about prayer, if we could just get serious about loving each other and serving each other, then we could really be the church. Then we could really be Christian. The idea is that what holds us back is our laziness when it comes to living the Christian life. Or rather, unless you are seeing progress in your lack of sinning, unless you are living a pretty good and decent life, then you're not a Christian. And part of that idea comes from this Sermon on the Mount, this passage out of Matthew chapter 5, as Jesus reveals himself to us today. Listen to what he says. He uses a couple of examples. He says, first, regarding murder. He said, "You have heard that it was said to those of old, 'You shall not murder.'" And we say, yep, that's the fifth commandment. God gave us that one on Mount Sinai through Moses. Maybe we all pat ourselves in the back and we say, well, I've never intentionally set out to put anyone in it. I'm good on that. But Jesus, he ups the ante. He turns up the heat a bit. He says, "I say to you that everyone who is angry with his brother will be liable to judgment." So, to Jesus, if you've ever been angry with anyone for anything, even once, you're a murderer. And second, regarding lust, he says, "You have heard that it was said you should not commit adultery." And we say, yep, that's the sixth commandment. Our culture isn't as good on that one, but we try our best. But Jesus ups to the ante on that one too. He says, "I say to you that if you've even had a single lustful thought ever, then you're an adulterer." He gives a couple other examples, but they're along the same lines. At the end of this section, he sums it all up with one devastating statement. "You, therefore, must be perfect as your Heavenly Father is perfect." So you can see how many Christians might see Christianity in terms of a strict morality. Always do right, never do wrong. If you do wrong, maybe you're not a Christian. And being a Christian means always doing right, always being nice, always being kind, always being good, never sinning. Being a Christian means being perfect. I once read a Christian parenting book along these lines. The author believed that you could teach your children to never sin. Their hope for salvation of their children was in teaching them to live an upright, moral, even sinless life. It's an idea called perfectionism. And isn't that what Jesus said? Be perfect as your Heavenly Father is perfect. See, because we are sinners, when we see a list of things to do, we often convince ourselves that we are up to the task. We'd love for salvation to be something that we do. For we all want to be perfect. Well, we all think pretty highly of ourselves anyway. So give me 10 reasons, 10 ways to please God. Give me 5 methods I can use to have a better marriage. Give me 3 simple things I can do to convince myself that I'm a believer. And I'll do it. Because I want to be perfect. Now, I'm not saying that we shouldn't train ourselves in righteousness. We can all use a good kick in the pants when it comes to not sinning as much. There is something to be said for encouraging one another to give each other the benefits of the doubt, to not jump into social media wars, to avoid pornography like the evil that it is, to dress modestly. These are all good things, and God commands them, and he really does expect us to do them. But when our faith is reduced to that, when what we believe is reduced to do good, 2 things happen: pride or despair. When we think that we're actually achieving the high standards of God's righteousness, we're led to pride. Look at me, what a good boy am I. I do everything God wants me to do and more. I am constantly in prayer. I read my Bible every day. I never miss church. I'm never mean to anyone. I should expect nothing but smooth sailing from here. My marriage should be perfect, my kids should be role models, my boss should give me a raise, and everyone should love me. That's pride. A prideful person doesn't need God because a prideful person has become his own God. He or she has everything they need, but the most important thing, the true God, who is not them. Because then what happens? Well, inevitably life happens. Sin happens. Your kids get in trouble. Your spouse decides to leave you. Your banker's upset you can't pay the mortgage. Your doctor tells you you have cancer. And you realize that you aren't half as good as you thought you were. Despair. Depression. We give up on God, on caring about God. We give up on thinking that God can do anything for you because, darn it, you kept your end of the bargain. Why is God doing this to me? Where is God in all of this? How could God let this happen to me, to my child, to my spouse? If I try so hard and God lets this happen to me anyway, why even try? Perfection is impossible anyway. That's despair. But you know what? This is the season of Epiphany. This is really not about Jesus telling us what to do, but about Jesus telling us about himself. See, for Jesus, we need for us to see Jesus, we need to get ourselves out of the way. For it is when we are weak that we are strong. It's when we realize that we have nothing that we really have something. It's when we acknowledge our helplessness that we finally find our help. For no one can live up to the strict, high standards of God's righteousness. What Jesus wants us to see is that on our own, we simply cannot be perfect enough to attain salvation. St. James got this. He says, if we keep the whole law, but fail at one point, we are guilty of breaking all of it. What we need is someone to keep it for us. And that's what Jesus is revealing about himself, that he is the perfect one. He is the righteous one. His love for us is such that he gets down into the muck of our sinful, broken lives. And he takes that filth on himself. And he takes it to the cross, where he puts our sin to death. Most lifeguards will tell you that if someone is thrashing and flailing in the water, struggling to keep their head above water, you have to be careful how you approach them. If you just jump in to rescue them, it's possible that they will push you under the water to hold themselves above it. In that process, the rescuer can become another victim. In order for the victim to be saved, he has to quit fighting and trying to do it himself and just trust his Savior. What Jesus is revealing about himself here in this Epiphany lesson is that when it comes to our salvation, the first thing we need to do is to stop doing. We can never do it well enough anyway. Any attempt we make just makes things worse. Instead, in faith, we trust Jesus to give us his righteousness. We trust in our baptism, which gives us all the promises of the kingdom of God. We trust in the Lord's Supper, which is Jesus feeding us with his own righteous, perfect body and blood. And in him, in Jesus, we are perfect. When we stand before our God in judgment the last day, he won't see us for the sinners that we are. For we are covered in Jesus' righteousness through baptism. His body and blood are joined with ours through the Lord's Supper. His word fills our mind through our faithful hearing of it. We are covered in Jesus. Christianity is not about living a perfect life. Moral improvements are a natural outcome of being a Christian, but they're not the thing that makes us into it. Rather, Christianity is about trusting in Jesus to be perfect for us. In the name of Jesus, amen. May the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, keep our hearts and our minds in the one true faith into life everlasting. Amen.